Let's go, girls.
Hello, and welcome back to Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm JC, and today I am telling the story of the terror of the South China Seas, inarguably the most successful pirate of all time. And as this is Feminist Cocktail Hour, you know what that means. It's a lady pirate, none other than Ching Shih. We're honoring her with a drink that I am calling a Lychee Lagoon. To make this drink, you are going to need some lychee syrup, some lemon juice, a little bit of blue Curacao, as well as some tequila. We're going to pair that with a feminist bite, some Crab Rangoon Cups. To make these, you're going to need some wonton wrappers, crab, some soy sauce, Worcestershire sauce, some green onions, and some cream cheese. Well, you go wrangle all of that up. I am going to start the story of Ching Shih. Now, the details of the early life of Ching Shih are somewhat unknown. To be fair, in fact, Ching Shih's entire life is somewhat shrouded in mystery. But the stories that we do know are full of the intrigue that you would expect of a pirate on the high seas. She was born in the Guangdong region of China in around 1775. She was part of an ethnic group called the Tonka, which literally means boat people. It's actually a term that's not used anymore. It's considered derogatory. Now, she may have been sold by her parents at some point or abandoned by them. Maybe. The thing is, again, we're really not sure. She may have had a completely normal childhood, but the end result was that by the time she was a teenager, she was working on a flower boat. This was pretty common for Tonka women in those days. Their economic situations were dire, and this was often their fate. As you might have guessed by now, flower boats had nothing to do with, you know, roses and tulips. These were floating brothels. And we don't really have any kind of equivalent of that today. Although, we all know that the cruise ship industry is going to be hurting. This might be a way to revitalize that industry. I'm just saying, throwing ideas out here, people. So, we're gonna use that as a quick segue to our food. We're talking about seafaring folk, so we are creating a little seafood bite. We're gonna start by creating the filling for our crab rangoon. We're gonna add 4 ounces of cream cheese, softened up a little bit, as well as 4 ounces of lump crab meat. Then we're going to put in about a teaspoon of soy sauce, a teaspoon of Worcestershire sauce, and a pinch of garlic, and then like one finely diced green onion. I'm gonna mix all that together. Now, as the presence of cream cheese might indicate, this is not actually an authentic Chinese recipe. This recipe rose to popularity in the 1950s. It apparently comes from a restaurant in San Francisco called Trader Vic's. It was on their Polynesian food menu, and the owner, who was very much a white guy, claimed that it was a Burmese traditional recipe. Now, I am by no means an expert on Burmese cuisine, but I promise you that Philadelphia cream cheese is not in any traditional Burmese food. So while I fold all of this together, I'm gonna get back to the story of Ching Shih. As a quick side note too, I'm calling our heroine Ching Shih, although she went by several different names over the course of her life. Ching Shih is the most famous name she went by. Women would change their names when they were married, when they were widowed. It's likely that her birth name was Shi Yang. We're not 100% sure, but it changed as soon as she met Ching Yi. Ching Yi was a notorious, very successful pirate on the high seas. He came from a long line of pirates. His father was a pirate, his grandfather was a pirate, his brothers, you guessed it, they were pirates too. So again, the circumstances around their meeting are a little bit sketchy, but what we do know is that at some point, Ching Yi made his way over to the flower boat for a good time, and he met Ching Shih, and he was not only taken by her extraordinary beauty, but by her wit and cunning. Ching Shih was known to be a woman who slept with all the most powerful, wealthy men on the South China Sea, and Ching Yi was all about this. He was like, girl, we have to get married. Even if we weren't that into each other, we should still get married. This is a great business move. You have such savvy with the gentleman, we can consolidate our power and influence. And Ching Shih was, of course, like, sure, I mean, what else am I doing? I'm hanging out here as a sex worker. I will totally go and be a pirate with you, but I have some ground rules. Basically, she drew up a contract that guaranteed she would have control of 50% of their assets. This was a totally unprecedented move, but it was super legit. This was not a handshake deal. She made sure that they had a contract drawn up, they both signed it, and there were witnesses. Now, with the business of marriage all wrapped up, they were all set to head on out and terrorize the seas. They wrapped that up. We're gonna do some wrapping of our own. We are going to take a mini muffin tin and we're going to put some wonton wrappers into it. I pre-sprayed this so that they'll be easily removed. We're gonna put one wonton wrapper in each of our little mini muffin spots. Once our wrappers are in place, we're going to add 1 to 2 teaspoons of our filling to each of our wonton wrappers before we pop our muffin tin into the oven for around 10 to 12 minutes at 350 degrees. With that all set up, we're gonna get back to the story of Ching Shih. Now, Ching Shih's new husband, Ching Yi, was a very good pirate. You know, he led his fleet with military precision and, you know, got a lot of booty. Not just money, by the way. There's also rumors that he had a young male lover on the side. Anyway, beyond all of that, Ching Yi saw the big picture. For instance, he realized he didn't have an heir, and so, you know, while he was pillaging around, he decided to steal one. He stole this, like, 15-year-old boy, Cheng Po Tsai, and actually, Ching Yi and Ching Shih officially adopted him so that they could guarantee there was an heir to their inheritance, even though he was a grown-ass man by that point. That's not that uncommon, actually, in those days, to adopt adult people because of coverture laws. Beyond that, Cheng Yi realized that the entire pirating world was kind of a mess. You know, there was a lot of infighting between these different factions of pirates, and it was distracting them from their primary goal of terrorizing the Chinese government and, you know, fucking up trade routes. So Ching Yi says, pirates, we gotta organize. We need some synergy up in here. He divided the 400 junk ships, that's what they were called, junks, into 6 different fleets, each of which sailed under their own flag and had their own territory. The flags were the black, the green, the yellow, the white, the blue, and the red flag. The red flag fleet was the largest and most powerful of these fleets, and that was, of course, Ching Yi's fleet. Now, during all of this, where was Ching Shih? Well, probably Ching Shih was the brains behind all of this. I mean, remember that before Ching Shih came along, Ching Yi was just sort of your average vengeful pirate. Ching Shih really brought him to the next level while doing all the stuff that pirate wives did. And that was actually pretty common, by the way. The Chinese pirates were not like the British depictions of pirates with these all-boy boats. Lots of them had wives on board, and these wives, you know, acted the way wives did in those days. They helped clean the ship, and they had babies. Ching Shih herself had 2 sons, which, by the way, must have been quite a feat in and of itself. I mean, we worry about exposing our kids to violence because of video games. These were 2 boys who just, like, lived their life on a floating crime syndicate. But beyond these normal wifely duties, Ching Shih was also the person holding the purse strings. The financial system of the entire pirate alliance was somewhat integrated. Basically, anytime you got loot, you got to keep 20% of it, but 80% of it went back to the alliance so they could, you know, basically create like social systems to support the pirates. Like if you were in a fleet that was having a lean year, there was a pirate welfare system, and all of that was designed and controlled by Ching Shih. She had all of the brains, and her husband had all of the bluster. That meant that she was twice as powerful and at least 3 times as feared. And Ching Yi would have done well to be a little more fearful of his wife because, oh, wouldn't you know it, 6 years into their marriage, he had some mysterious accident where he fell into the sea and died. Back to that in a second. But first, we want to get into our sea-colored cocktail. We're going to start off this cocktail with 2 ounces of lychee juice. or lychee syrup. You can drain it out of the can, or you can juice actual lychees. Now, unlike our crab rangoon, which has no relationship to China, lychee juice does. Lychees are primarily grown in the Guangdong region of China, which is actually where Ching Shih is from. We're going to add to that 1 ounce of blue curacao and 1 ounce of lemon juice. Now, I'm calling this cocktail a Lychee Lagoon, and I would like to tell you that that's because it's sort of a riff on a blue lagoon cocktail, and it kind of is. It has blue curacao and it has lemon juice, both of which are found in a blue lagoon. But instead of a vodka base, we are using a tequila base, so that makes it somewhat different. We are going to add 1.5 ounces of our tequila to our cocktail before we shake it. And the thing is, I really called it a Lychee Lagoon, not because of the ingredients so much as I like the alliteration. And it seems like a lagoon is, you know, where pirates would hang out. Speaking of pirates, back to Ching Shih. So Ching Shih falls overboard, and there's a lot of conjecture as to why. Was there some kind of storm? Was he, you know, drinking too much? Or did his wife push him overboard? Right after his death, though, surprisingly, it is Ching Shih who comes into power. And none of the other pirates have any, like, argument with this, which makes me definitely think that she killed him and they just didn't want to fight with him. Now, you might be asking yourself, JC, you told me before that they had actually adopted this grown-ass man, Cheng Po Cai, to become their heir. What happened to him? Didn't he want to be in charge? Well, don't you worry, because Ching Shih had that down on lock. She knew how to deal with Cheng Po Cai. She started having sex with him, and so he was like, oh, nah, it's cool. My, you know, girlfriend slash mommy can totally be the queen of the pirates. And that she was. Now, Ching Shih did shift the balance of power a little bit once she came into control. The power became a little more centralized on the Red Flag Fleet, giving again Ching Shih more power. She also altered some of the rules. For instance, if you disobeyed a rule, an order that Ching Shih gave, you were immediately beheaded, no trial. If you stole from the kitty once, you know, you were beaten. Twice, beheaded. If you raped any women, beheaded, no questions asked. If you committed adultery, beheaded. If you had consensual sex with a woman that you were not married to, beheaded. And the woman that you had sex with, very much drowned, which, by the way, super hypocritical. She was sleeping with her stepson, right? But in spite of the fact that she was so brutal, she actually got a lot of respect from the lieutenants who were beneath her because she was a great delegator. Those in the Red Flag Fleet who were under her did receive more authority than they had had before. Additionally, she was very smart tactically. She determined that it wasn't enough to just be, you know, raiding the trading ships that came in and, like, taking captors, which they did quite a lot of, by the way. Mostly men. If they had women, they would, you know, for the most part, send them back. Really, they judged them and they would, like, send the ugly ones back and then, you know, keep the pretty ones for wives. That was the misogynistic pirate code. Anyway, she also decided that a good way to maintain a steady income was to terrorize the coastal towns. That way, if, you know, things were getting quiet on the trade routes, they always had this, you know, consistent, steady income. Proactive thinking. At the height of her powers, Ching Shih had 800 large chunks and more than 1,000 smaller ships. By comparison, Blackbeard had only 4 ships and controlled 300 pirates. Ching Shih was at one point in charge of more than 70,000 men. She controlled the South China Seas like this for a good 2-3 years before she started to get in some serious scuffles with the British, Portuguese, and Chinese governments, all sort of at the same time. Now, she had gotten out of jams like this before, but she found herself literally stuck in the Pearl Delta and had to surrender after one particularly brutal battle called the Battle of the Tiger's Mouth. After this, the Chinese government was so afraid of her still that they granted her amnesty. All she had to do was hand over 100 pirates for them to execute, mostly symbolically, and then she was allowed to do what no one does. She retired peacefully from being a pirate, and she got to keep all of her loot. I know, right? What a sweetheart deal. Now, we are going to do something pretty sweet. We are going to strain this cocktail into our glass. I'm going to do one last shake here.
We'll pour it on in. Ooh, it's got a nice blue color. Very nautical. I'm going to give it a taste. Let's try it. Oh, it's good. It's great. When you have a blue lagoon, they can sometimes be really sweet. The tequila gives this a nice bite, a nice edge. Let's try it with our delicious crab rangoon cups. Now, I've put a little bit of sweet and sour sauce on top of my crab rangoons. You could make this from scratch, but I chose to use something that was out of a bottle from Trader Joe's. And I think that, you know, when you're making party food like this, you want it to be fun. You want it to be easy. Don't overthink it. Let's try it. So good. What's nice about the bite is that you get a lot of that crab flavor, and it pairs beautifully with the sweetness of the cocktail. The whole thing is sweet and delicious. Nothing like Ching Shih. Although, we don't know a lot about the end of Ching Shih's life. She lived to be 69 years old, and I don't know, maybe she ended up being a very sweet old lady. She had a couple more kids. Maybe she was like a kindly old grandma who, you know, gave her grandkids Werther's originals. Or maybe she took that fortune that she had and she gave it to the Tonka women so that they didn't have to sell themselves into sexual slavery. Or, you know, maybe the rumors are true. Maybe she opened a casino and a brothel and had a second husband die mysteriously at sea. Knowing a little about Ching Shih, which is exactly how much we know, sounds like it's probably the latter. I hope that you enjoyed this episode of Feminist Cocktail Hour. I'm going to be back tomorrow. I'm going to have a new lady, a new libation. Until then, cheers.
Let's go, girls.